Okay, so today we'll discuss so-called toric varieties. Toric. So there's some abstract definition. What is it? Abstract definition is the following. Variety. Toric variety is actually not just a variety, but a pair. Is a pair. Actually, triple. Is a triple. G acting on X such that X is an algebraic variety. So I have some space, some group, an action of a group on a space. So morally it means that my group is mapped into automorphisms of those of a space. For every space it's automorphisms as a group, and I have some homomorphism from some group to this group. So for every element here I have some automorphism. So X is an algebraic variety, something that locally given by zeros of polynomials and then glued from charts. G is a split torus, so G is G M to the N torus. So this is just a group, just GM, as I recall, is group of invertible numbers, right? So if I have any ring, I look for invertible elements of this ring, and they give me a group with respect to multiplication. If I have a field, invertible elements, just everything without zero. And this guy itself has a structure of variety. It's an algebraic group. I can just give it by it's S variety. It is just a fine line without a point. Right? I take all numbers and throw away zero, and then it looks like a variety. So if you like, we can stick to complex example, then it's just C star. Right, so I have some complex variety and just the group of complex numbers without zero, and take some copies of it. So it's n-dimensional torus, n-dimensional algebraic torus. In fact, when you do this definition, we don't have to supply what is n. It can be anything. And g on x is an algebraic action, so it's given again by algebraic functions such that G has an open Zariski dense orbit on X. We can remove Zariski dense just by saying that X is irreducible algebraic variety. It does not split on the union of some varieties. Okay, so that's an abstract definition. So it's a variety plus action of a group such that the group is torus and it has an open orbit. If the orbit is open, it's automatically dense, right? So it means that the orbit is given by some inequalities, some functions non-equals to zero. So the complement to this orbit is given by some equations. It has higher codimension. And so there's an abstract definition, and there's some very concrete constructions in terms of the things like on this blackboard. Usually when you work with toric varieties, it's very useful to have some paper with cells, so at least with a grid to draw pictures. And there's some classification theorem. So given this abstract definition, I can ask myself, so what is the, how actually to construct one? So first you can notice that if you have some torus with Zariski open orbit, you take any point inside this orbit and look for stabilizer, right? So stabilizer will be some subgroup inside this torus. So if I have P, let's this orbit be O. So if I have P inside O, then I can take stabilizer of P. These are the elements of the group that map this point to itself, right? So that's G inside G, such that G of P equals to P. It will be some subgroup inside G, and well, it's automatically a normal group because the torus is commutative. So the quotient group, it will act. So the G mod stabilizer of P, it also acts on X, but now it acts effectively. For every element, it acts non-trivial. Yeah? And the quotient is again a torus. If you take any subgroup inside torus and take the quotient, it's again a torus. So you can assume that your torus has the same dimension as X. Right? Because when you have an effective action, then you can identify your orbit with your group. So can assume action that action is effective. Then if action is effective, I have my group acts on this orbit transitively and effectively. It means if I have chosen any point in the orbit and identify it with, say, identity element, then my orbit is just isomorphic to my group. Then this implies that O is isomorphic to G. So we see that the torus, it will lie inside my variety, right? So automatically, so this variety have to be some kind of compactification or maybe partial compactification of a torus. Then you can discuss what are the divisor, what are the co-dimension one sub-varieties inside my variety. Before we discuss that if we have divisors, then there's some relation. Two divisors are called linearly equivalent. If their difference is a divisor of a function, or there was some more geometric definition, two divisors were called rationally equivalent, which is the same. If there exists some divisor on product of my variety with projective line, such that restriction to one fiber is one divisor and restriction to the other fiber is another divisor. So it's easy to see that if you have an action of a torus, then any divisor is rationally equivalent to some divisor on the complement to the open orbit. So the idea is the following. So if you have some divisor, then you just take action of your group and then it will map it somewhere to the boundary. Just take some subgroup, generic maybe subgroup of here. Just the group will isomorphic to GM, and then this group, it will just map it somewhere to the exterior. So every divisor, it's equivalent to one of the divisors on the boundary. And this is this divisors on the boundary on the complement is the same as we can tell that they're invariant with respect to a torus. That they map not point-wise invariant, but invariant as the whole set. So just if I have an abstract variety, there are finitely many invariant, G-invariant divisors. In other words, I take the open orbit, take the complement, it's an algebraic variety, and it's consists of finitely many components, and among these components, there are finitely many components of co-dimension one and minus one dimensional G-invariant divisors. And so then maybe if I want to have some compactification of a torus, I can ask myself just how to add just one divisor to the torus. Is it possible just to have a torus and add maybe just one divisor? So locally, this compactification looks like, let's look for the simplest example, one-dimensional. So I have a torus, what is it? It's a projective line without two points. So I can say it's a fine line without a point. And I want to compactify it. Well, the simplest example of compactification is to put this point back, right? I have a torus and it's missing two points and I just want to add a point. So I have GM inside A1. And in fact, it is exactly the same in higher dimensions. I just multiply by the remaining torus, gm to the n minus 1 times gm inside gm to the n minus 1 times A1. So my divisor, it again will have an action of a torus, but it will have a stabilizer, it will be one-dimensional subgroup. In fact, divisors are also toric varieties, so it's a little bit inductive. So this is how compactification looks, but there are many of such compactifications. There are as many as actually choices of this decomposition, in some sense. And in fact, some decompositions give you the same, but the right answer, there are as many as characters of your group. So all possible compactifications, they correspond to homomorphisms from gm to the n to gm. And this homomorphism is just a lattice. It's an n-dimensional lattice z to the n. Yeah, for every, if I choose some generators here, for every generator, I need to supply some integer number. Like to what power of generator here it goes. So it's homomorphism from n-dimensional torus to the torus. For every such homomorphism, I can think of it as a function, right? So every such homomorphism is some particular invertible function on a torus. It's some algebraic function that's invertible, and I want to add it zeros. That's the whole idea. So divisor will be zeros of this function. So here, just for gm inside a1, I had function z, for example, and I want to add the point z equals to zero. But also I have function 1 over z, and then I want to add the point when 1 over z equals to zero, so it's in other coordinates w equals to zero. And maybe I want to say that if I have a function, I can take its square. Then what I end for z square equals to zero, it's the same point. So let's say, in fact, it means that we have to choose not all homomorphism, but only primitive. Correspond to primitive elements in here. So the vector inside the lattice is called primitive if it is non-zero and cannot be, is not multiple of any other vector. So, for example, vector 1, 0, or minus 1, 0, or 0, 1, these are primitive. This guy is primitive, this guy is primitive, but this guy is not. If I have vector 2, 2, then it's twice vector 1, 1, 1, so it corresponds essentially to the same. Or, for example, 2, 0 is not primitive, and so on. Okay. So, if I know this, then I already see that in some way that if I have this abstract definition, it should correspond to some combinatorics or some geometry of an integer lattice. So the lattice is just, there's natural lattice, the representations of your torus, the characters, it's called. Usually this lattice is called M. If you look for Fulton's book, it's the standard notation. The lattice of characters, the invertible functions on your torus, is M. That's a very nice property actually of a torus, that it has very natural basis. That does not true for a fine line itself. So, like if you look for all invertible functions on a fine line without zero, then they are given as Laurent polynomials, monomials. This monomials, some constant times x to the n, and any Laurent polynomial, any regular function, is just uniquely can be expressed as linear combination of Laurent monomials. So for torus, there's a distinguished lattice. It's a very nice property, but for, say, a fine line, there's no such thing. In modern science, people say that gm is affine Calabi-Yau. Okay, so we have this lattice, and some geometry related to this lattice should be related to the torus. Now I'll go a little bit away from abstract definition and just give you an explicit construction, how to construct such a thing. So maybe some examples first. First examples, then construction examples. So if I look to dimension zero, there's nothing. The unique toric variety is just a point. In dimension one, there are one, two, three, at least three toric varieties. Right? So if dimension of x equals to one, so g is just gn. So first example, I can just always take a torus itself, and in any dimension, the very basic toric variety is just the torus itself, not compactified in any way. So another thing, I can take a fine line, A1. And the third thing, can take a projective line. Right, so on the projective line, the torus acts by, say, multiplication of the first coordinate, say, ZW goes to alpha times ZW, alpha inside. If I work with this abstract definition, there are actually, in fact, infinitely many one-dimensional toric varieties. Because I just told it's an irreducible. Huh? Gen, since I always have this rational curve, I see that field of functions is just field of rational functions of one variable. But so this is list of normal varieties. These are all normal. And there's some non-normal. So what does non-normal say? Let me give just a construction and you'll see how to construct it. So take any A construction. Of non-normal projective varieties, of projective toric varieties that may fail to be normal, may fail to be normal. So take any subset inside this lattice, inside characters. So let A inside M, A inside M, then any finite subset, any finite subset. So if you look for one-dimensional example, what is the M? M is just Z. It's just the lattice of integer numbers, right? We look for all homomorphism from a circle to itself, from torus to itself. These are given by monomials. Z goes to Z to the n. N is any integer. And any subset here corresponds to any choice set of integers, any finite set of integers. So here m equals to Z. Gm to Gm. Let's call it phi m. Z goes to Z to the m. This map, yeah? and now consider the map from just a collection of elements. So here it's a collection of numbers. We can, for example, choose them to be ordered. If you like, you can take subset with multiplicities, but it will be a little bit boring. So it's safe to assume that all them are distinct. So it's A1 and so on, AN. Say I have N elements here. So it corresponds to n functions on my torus. Now consider a map to such A. We can associate a map phi A from the torus G from G. So again, G is my Gm to the n. Often it's denoted by T because it's a torus and G for some by the group. And M is home. G, Gm. From G to the projective space of dimension n minus 1. And what is the map? If I have some point, say, Z inside here, then it goes to phi A1 of Z, and so on, phi A n of z. You also can construct affine toric varieties by the same construction, just instead of projective coordinates, use the usual coordinates, or can do affine version as well. Affine, just z goes to phi a 1 of z, and so on, phi a n of z. So this gives you some mapping, and this the image is some algebraic variety, but it may fail to be the risky closed, and just take a closure of the image. Yeah, so now PTA, or PA, so it's phi A of G closure, which means that if I have some collection of points, it might the limit might not lie inside the image, but just add all the possible limits. The risk closure another way is just take all polynomials that vanish there and look for all their zeros. And that's a construction, so you got a variety, that's compactification of the torus, and such that the torus acts there with an open orbit. This gives you affine, this gives you projective. What is the action of let's look maybe for one dimensional example. What does it say to me? I just choose some collection of numbers and then look for the image. So I will have some parameterized curve in some space. So so how the torus acts there, right? So note that G naturally acts on say A n by the following formula. So if you have some collection of numbers, Z1, Zn, then for every of them, you use the character of the torus that corresponds to this index. So it goes to, so if I have lambda inside my group G, so under lambda, it goes to phi, phi A1 of lambda, basically. Let's lambda to, it's more useful to write this notation. It's the same as this phi when I just write lambda to the power. And this example shows you that why it makes sense, right? So here I really have one monomial and put it to the power. And in higher dimension, it's some kind of multi-index. You have a couple of maybe monomials and then multiply it, like zi to the ai. So lambda to ai, a1, z1, and so on, lambda to an. So I have some natural action of my group on the affine space and as well on its projectivization, right? So if I rescale everything, we see that they commute on A, M, and this is big M, and P, N minus one. And this action, it induces me the same action like on the image, it gives me the same action as I had of the group on itself. So this shows me that really variety obtained by this construction is a toric variety in this sense. It's reducible because it's the risky closure of an irreducible, it's automatic. And predicted to image of phi A is the standard action. Okay, so now let's just do it for one-dimensional case and see what happens. Uh, If we choose some, let's look for affine case. Affine. So if we choose, for example, just one element, say only if A is 1, what is this variety? I've chosen just one monomial, Z. And then I map invertible number, just numbers that are not zero, goes to Z, that's the map. So the image is everything without zero, then I take the risky closure and I add the zero. Right? So image is A1. Now say, let's take A that consists of maybe two numbers, 1 and 2. So here I have Z goes to Z, and here I have Z goes to Z and Z squared. What will be the image? It's some curve on a plane, which is called parabola. Right? So if it is x and this is y, then I see that y equals to x squared, so some parabola. But it's an abstract algebraic variety, it's still A1. Yeah? Because I can express y in terms of x, so functions on the thing is the same as functions of x, just polynomials of x. Well, we can take, say, A equals to 1, 2, 3. Then this will be the map Z goes to Z, Z squared, Z cubed. If you take 0, we can take it or we cannot take it. Doesn't really matter because this coordinate will be constant. Right? So the coordinate that corresponds to 0 is constant. So this map is more complicated. It's the twisted cubic that we discussed. The image is a twisted cubic. It's already given, but not by one equation, but by three equations. You can say that rank of this matrix rank of 1 x, y, z equals to 1. In other words, y equals to x squared, z times x equals to y squared, and z equals to xy. You cannot give it by just... Actually, you can, but that doesn't matter. One of them we can express in terms of the other. Projectively, you cannot give it by two equations, but in affine space you can. So the image is still in affine line. How to do something more interesting? So similarly, if you take interval of this one, so it will be isomorphism. Not isomorphism, to the image we have to close, right? To add the point when z equals to zero. That's essentially what we had. Now let's do something different. Let's take A equals to 1 and 3. So here the map z goes to z and z cube. This is also boring, right? So because here y equals to x cube. But now let's take 2 and 3. Z goes to z squared, z cube. So first of all, I want to say that the map to its image is an isomorphism, right? Because if this is x and this is y, then I can say that z equals to y divided by x. Right? So the points, they do not glue together. The image itself is a GM, but it's not closed. And how to close it? I need to find some algebraic relation between x and y. Quite clear that this relation is x cube equals to y squared. And this corresponds to some picture like this. So we got a curve that is singular in point zero. And well, quite similarly, you can get various different things like that. So you have different choices of what points you take, which you don't, and this will give you some kind of toric singularities. So various curves. So if you look for plane curve, you just choose two numbers. It will be similar. X to the A equals to Y to the B. Some kind of generalized cuspidal curves. Or you can make some complicated singular curves in a space again. The important thing is you have either to throw away something or not to take Z or something like that. Well, similarly for projective variety, you can just take a little bit more and you'll have it. So we see that there are already might be way too much of them, even in dimension one, but most of these examples, they correspond to non-normal things. And you can notice that if you take normalization of your variety, that's some normal variety that has a map to our variety, such that for any other map from normal variety to other variety, it goes through this map. Or algebraically, normalization corresponds, like normalization of a fine variety is just adding all the, it's an integral closure. For example, here we have ring k of xy modulo x cube minus y square. So this function is a rational function, but it is also integer. It satisfies, if I take z square, then it equals to y square divided by x square, but y square is x cube, so it equals to x. So z belongs to field of fractions of this ring, but also it satisfies an equation with first coefficient one. All coefficients inside this ring, first coefficient is one, it's integer. So it means that I can add this element, this is the normalization. Integral closure of a ring corresponds to normalization of my variety. Z square minus x equals to zero. So we see z is integral okay, in ring of field of fractions. Doing something similar to that, you always get the normal toric variety. And for normal toric variety, there's already nice pictures that how we can, to every normal toric variety, we can associate just some very combinatorial thing. Well, this thing was also kind of combinatorial, as you see. You have to choose some collection, something like this. Maybe some particular case of this construction is so-called, is also called polytope construction. So. Polytope construction. Well, let's delta inside M will be integral polytope, integral convex polytope. Then take A equals to delta inside M times R. So that's so we have a just convex hull of a finite collection of points in our lattice. This is what's called integral convex polytope. So its vertices lie inside our lattice. Then A equals to delta intersected with M. Let's call it A delta. If you just do the construction of projective variety with this particular set, then our variety will be automatically normal, and this is called the polytope construction. So given some integral polytope, I can associate to a toric variety like that. It is almost true, there's some k in it. So slightly, we can slightly generalize it, slightly more general, slightly more general. So instead of taking integer polytope, we can take a rational polytope, which means a polytope whose vertices are just convex hull of finite number of rational vectors, vectors with rational coefficients. So if delta is a rational polytope, then take C over delta. So delta is inside R n, and C over delta is inside R n times R. And it's given by pairs of vectors V and H. Let's H will be height function. So one new coordinate I denoted by H, and you can think of putting your polytope, like of having a height, like my Rn being a floor, and in the space I just put the polytopes on the table, and they can choose some point zero here and take a cone with vertex and zero over this polytope. Yeah, taking all the lines passing through here and to the say this polytope on the table. So this V and H such that H is non-negative, and there essentially I want to say that V divided by H belongs to delta. But I cannot divide by zero, right? So I can say that H is positive and V divided by H belongs to delta union with zero, zero, to add the vertex. That's exactly how I do it. For every point in my delta, right, I just look for the ray passing through this point and take the whole ray. So this is a rational convex cone. So rational convex cone, by definition, there are two dual definitions. Either it's all possible, let me write it somewhere. Inside MR. So M is Z to the M, this characters of my torus, and MR is M times R, so this R to the N. I embed my lattice inside the space, right? So you can think MR is just the blackboard itself, and M is the blue dots on the blackboard. So C inside MR is a rational convex cone if any of two equivalent. Okay, so it's definition and proposition. So definition lemma. So for C inside MR, the following are equivalent. First, so there exists some vectors V1 and so on, V, say call it B. okay, N. V1, Vn is V. N, V1, Vk inside M, such that any for any point P inside C exists alpha 1, alpha k inside non-negative numbers such that P equals to alpha 1 V1 plus alpha k Vk. In other words, it's just a cone generated by finite collection of vectors, and these vectors lie inside my lattice. So they are rational or integer, you can take them integer. Yeah, and second is that there exists some L1 and so on, L. Now it's not K, it's some different letter. Let's call it F. L1, LF inside M dual, which is by definition homomorphisms from M to Z. This is the linear functions on M. So I have the space, some vector space, or maybe lattice, and I can consider the dual space of all linear functionals on my space. And usually in toric geometry, this after Fulton, this is denoted by N. On G. So lattice called M is lattice of characters, elements of M, they correspond to functions on our group, as you can recall. And N is the dual lattice, it's usually called fun lattice. N is hom M Z, it's fun. I will explain what is a fun on the next half of the lecture. So I have collection of elements in the dual lattice inside, say, M. M. Such that for every P inside C, well, can just say for every functional, it gives me a half space. So given L inside M, I can consider HL, that's V inside MR, such that L of V is non-negative. Yeah? Every vector in the dual, every linear function gives me, I can look when it's non-negative, so it's a half space. And I want just to say that C is intersection of these guys, HL1 intersected with and so on, HLF. So one point of view on the convex cone, it's a convex hull of finitely many Russian vectors, and vectors have rational coefficients or integer. Another point of view, it's an intersection of finitely many hyperplanes, half spaces bounded by hyperplanes, and these equations of these half spaces also have rational or integer coefficients. Yeah. So these two numbers are different, right? So we can look, for example, for the minimal number of generators in this way, or minimal number of generators in this way. So this corresponds to how many, essentially, vertices. If I take, for example, cone polytope, if I start from a polytope, then number k, minimal number k is number of vertices of a polytope, and minimal number f is number of faces of a polytope. So if I look for two-dimensional case, it's more or less obvious than both numbers are two, right? So I have two generators, and also it's intersection of two hyperplanes. I can see it. For examples of cones are here. For example, I can have these two generators. This is V1 and V2, and half planes is this half plane and this half plane. Everything to the up and everything to the right. And similarly to here, here, here. So examples of the cones are already abundant on the other board. And you can see that it's very easy to prove that if you have this, then you have that, another way around. These are two dual pictures, in a sense. Now, if I have this thing, I can also define what is a dual cone. I will need. Okay, so I have a cone. So if I have rational polytope, then the cone over this rational polytope is a rational convex. If I have rational convex polytope, then its cone is a rational convex cone. It's one of the definition of rational convex polytopes, actually. Consider this way. And you want it to be bounded. If it's not bounded, it's called polyhedra, I think, instead of a polytope. It's also possible, but let's look for the polytope. So it lies on some. So I can consider this cone, and then to every cone, I can associate a cone algebra. Given a cone, given this, always by cone, I from now on will mean this rational convex cone. Given a cone C, consider a cone algebra K of C, sum of A. A n z to the n, where n belongs to m intersected with c. Yeah, by z to the n, I mean the character of my torus that corresponds to n. Yeah, so this is some kind of generalized monomial. And a, n are just numbers. A, n belongs to k. So it's some subset of all Laurent polynomials, k of g. And then this algebra has finitely many generators. It's finitely generated, so it corresponds to some affine variety, right? I just can choose any generators, and this gives me an embedding, gives me some sub-variety of this thing. So x, well, we can consider spec of k of c. As we will see, it's more useful to first dualize this cone and then take its cone algebra. That we'll do just after the break. After the break, we'll discuss what is an affine toric variety and how to glue them into pieces and what these pictures look like. What this picture, what's the meaning of the pictures I have there? So this is definition of rational convex cone, and there are plenty of them just drawn here on the blackboard. This red one, orange one, two yellow cones, four very basic cones, and some other yellow, and these cones also in green. So in fact, if we look for those cones, the z-square lattice, it has some big group of automorphisms, right? If I'm chosen to some bases, there are many bases. So it has automorphism group that's called GL to Z. It's all possible matrices A, B, C, D, such that determinant. So I want this matrix to be invertible and inverse to be also integer matrix. If I have an invertible matrix, then its determinant is also invertible. So I have an invertible integer number. Invertible integer numbers are either plus one or minus one. So M. So that's integer matrix, invertible integer matrix. Determinant of M equals to one. So A D minus B C equals to one. And for every matrix, I can associate two basic vectors. So there are many choices of a basis inside this lattice. So I have some standard basis, maybe 0, 1, and 1, 0, maybe standard, a basis. And then for any m, the corresponding a, b, and c, d will be another basis. So the basis of the lattice are in one-to-one correspondence with such matrices with integer coefficients such that AD minus BC equals to 1. So it's some, this is non-trivial group. We have some elements like 1, 1, 0, 1, for example, or 1, 0, 1, 0, or maybe minus 1, 0, 0, 1. Yeah. So these are elements of this group. And in fact, these elements, they generate the whole group. This is very easy to prove using Euclid's algorithm. If you have some two vectors, then you can either subtract one from another or maybe add one to another. You can decrease the maximal number here. Corollaries of this Euclid's algorithm is the following. For any primitive vector v inside Z2, or in fact, it's also true for Zn, there exists some M such that in automorphisms of Z2, such that M of V equals to 0, 1. So if I have some just two primitive vectors up to change of coordinates, I can make one of them just equal to standard 0, 1. It's again just Euclid's algorithm, nothing there. So now, if I have some cone in say, two-dimensional space, let's again stick. Maybe today I will explain just in two dimensions, and next week I'll go to higher. If I have some two-dimensional cone, then I can choose two generators. So as long as it's let's discuss what are the possibilities for cones on a plane. Yeah? What are the convex rational cones on a plane? Here's the definition. And maybe first is, what are the cones on the line? So dimension equals to 1. M equals to 1. So inside a line, I actually have, how many rational polyhedral cones I have on a line? Can I guess the number? So somebody says 3, somebody says 2, maybe more?
3.
Any other ideas? Actually, 4, yeah. So there are 4 different cones. So first cone is just 0. Second cone is, say I have coordinate z. So second is non-negative numbers. Third is non-positive numbers. And fourth is just all real numbers. Yes, these are 4 cones. And these two cones, they're actually very important. For example, if I take cone algebra of this guy, what do I get? I get my original torus. Right? So cone, what is the K of C4 is my torus, Gm. K of C2 is A1 of CI4. I equals to 2 and 3. So this is k of z to the plus minus 1. So this is k of z and k of z minus 1. They are isomorphic abstractly, but there are different embeddings of polynomials inside Laurent polynomials. There are 2 embeddings, actually. There are more, but here there are 2 embeddings that give you the same 2 birational embeddings, so to say. And k of C1 is just a point. Right? I don't allow myself any polynomials, so it is just a point. So this cone is a little bit boring, but so this gives me something one-dimensional, but everything else gives me something. This is gives me zero-dimensional variety. Everything else gives me something one-dimensional. So there's Gm and 2 possible compactifications of this Gm. Now, what are n equals to 2 case? Yeah, so n equals 2. How many different topologies a cone can have? How many distinct pictures of a cone I can draw? So the number actually is 7. There are 7 types, or maybe slightly more. So one is just 0, another is a ray, so some ray. So third one is a line. Fourth one is the half space. Now just something that is really a cone, this or the same as this. Angle doesn't matter because we can do these transformations. When we do this transformation, the angle can change. The angle is not invariant. But this really have 2 things. And also the whole space.
Why half plane is different from an angle?
Why half plane is different from this guy? In which way it's different? Let's see. Well, it's some kind of degenerate case of an angle, right? You can think of the angle goes to here, but here we have two elements that are, what's the characteristic property? So here we have V and minus V, and for this guy, we have only one of them. That's essentially the difference. So for every cone, you can define what's called a socle.
But can one side be missing?
Sir?
Can one side be missing?
Just can one what?
Side. You can just subtract one side of the cone. Is it correct? Or?
So my cones are closed, so you cannot subtract. Okay. Because if you subtract, the cone algebra will be infinitely generated. Right. So that's a problem. So. And it will not fit to my definition, right? Because it's not a convex hull of finitely many points, and it's not given by any equations. Yeah. Okay, so for every of these examples, let's look for what the varieties we actually get. Right, so for a point, so zero looks like not so nice, it again gives me a point. Slightly degenerate case, but let's look for the whole space. Whole space gives me again Laurent polynomials k of x plus minus 1, y plus minus 1, and the variety is gm square. Now, what the half space corresponds to? So these are Laurent polynomials in x, but usual polynomials in y. Yeah, so it gives me k of x plus minus 1 y. So that's a product of gm times a 1. That's the compactification we spoke about. We compactified by y equals to 0, adding 1. Simple. now, so what else? What do we have for a line? If you take the line, then it will give me k of, say, x plus minus 1. If I take ray, it gives me k of x. And the most interesting case is this one, if it's really a cone, right? So all these things, they are equivalent. So if you have any picture like that, you can find a you can find transformation invertible integer matrix that will map it to a standard one using, again, the same Euclid's algorithm. But now if the cone is the most interesting case, there are infinitely many actually examples. There are discrete by infinitely many. Integer cones, rational cones, structures. And it's not so easy, not so hard to classify them all. So how to classify them? If I'm given such a cone, it has just two generators, and for each generator I can choose the primitive integral vector, right? So I have two primitive integral vectors, v1 and v2, and other way around. If I'm given two primitive integral vectors, I can consider the cone generated by these two vectors. So there are as many of such cones as pairs of primitive vectors up to automorphisms of the lattice. So they correspond to pairs u, v inside m up to, so u, m primitive up to automorphisms of m. And as we discussed, one of them we can just make some standard vector, say 0, 1, and then we have the second one. So without loss of generality, u is 0, 1, and v is some a and b. And then what is the stabilizer of a vector 0, 1 inside this group? Now, if we fix it to be 0, 1, we allowed much less transformations, only those that preserve 0, 1. So stabilizer of an element 0, 1. It's some matrix A, B, C, D. So if I put 0, 1 here, then I get B and D. Right, and I want it to be 0, 1. So B equals to 0, D equals to 1. So it's matrix A, B, A, 0, C, 1. But I want determinant to be plus minus 1, right? So determinant of this matrix equals to A. So A equals to plus minus 1. We see it's very, very, very small stabilizer, actually. It's generated by two matrices. Minus 1, 0, 0, 1, and 1, 0, 1, 1. So one of them just corresponds changing to essentially v goes to minus v, and this corresponds to v goes to v plus u. Yeah? So I can choose some orientation on my plane and ask to make a pair of these vectors so they are oriented, which basically means that if I take their coordinates, then determinant is positive. So in other words, say A is more than zero. I can also choose, then I get rid of this guy. And then I have just only one transformation remaining. So, and this is the whole classification, right? So the all cones, they correspond to just pair of integers with these properties. A is positive and B is from 0 to A. There's, yeah.
Isn't it just B equals to 0 if you allow adding U?
No, B, like what this transformation will do, it will make, map B to B plus A. If you apply this transformation to this vector, then B goes to B plus A. So you can just divide with remainder, so you can make B remainder of B modulo A, but you cannot make it zero. So one invariant is A. A is essentially, what is it? It's determinant of a matrix generated by U and V. In other words, it's the area between those two things. So it's, you can think of this area of parallelogram that's generated by U and V. U, V. There is no metric on the integer plane, but the area is there, actually. So area is well defined. Essentially, you can ask area of any basic parallelogram to be 1, and it's how many basic parallelograms inside this one. Other way, you can think of A as the following. You take matrix M, take lattice M equals to Z square, and then take a sublattice generated by U and V, ZU plus ZV. So it's, again, lattice of rank 2, and take the quotient. Quotient is a finite group, and that's just the size of this group. So A is also M modulo ZU plus ZV, size of this group. So A is some invariant that has particular meaning, and B is some extra invariant. So we see that for any value of A, there exists exactly A minus... there's actually another condition. So you want this vector to be primitive. So it means that A and B are coprime. Greatest common divisor of A and B equals to 1. Right? So if you have A equals to 1, they're just a unique vector. All bases are equivalent to each other. Right? So A equals to 1. So there's a unique cone. That's a basic cone, basic. And it's here on this picture. This is just this one. Yeah? Essentially, it means that you can choose your generators, this to be x and this to be y, and your cone algebra is just an algebra of two polynomials of two variables. And if A is more than 1, If A is more than one, there exists Euler number of possibilities for the cone, right? Because we want number B to be co-prime with A and less than A. So it's the same. It's essentially, the B is well-defined is Z mod A star. That's a more normal definition. So A more than one, there's phi of A distinct cones. In particular, for A equals to 2, the choice is again unique. There's a unique cone, unique pair of two vectors with area equals to 2, and they are drawn here, this example. And we see that this algebra is not a polynomial algebra. We have to choose three generators, because if you throw away 0 and take the convex hull, then we have three integer points on the finite boundary. So this corresponds in some way to x squared, this to y squared, and this xy in the picture that we discussed when I take xy modulo minus 1. If you take a equals to 3, then there are two coprime numbers, 1 and 2, and there are two possibilities, two distinct cones with area 3. They are drawn here. So this is one of them, this is another of them. You can see geometrically clearly that they are distinct, because here we have... if you take the, again, take the complement to 0 and take the convex hull. So here we have just one line, and here we will have two lines, one and the other. So in other words, if you take the convex hull of 0 and two generators, then here in interior there's nothing, and here in the interior we have one point. Right, so one of them corresponds to A equals 2. To B equals to 1, another to B equals to 2. Okay. So in dimension 2, at least, it's something that doesn't have, not something complicated. We can classify all the cones and look for their cone algebras. if we have this kind of cones, they give me some algebras like, and let's recall what we did on the exercises. So what I want to say, that all varieties that you get this way are the quotients of a fine plane by a cyclic group. Algebras of polynomials on quotients of A2 by C. C is Z mod A, Z. And this A is the same. So how to quotient A2 by a cyclic group? Again, I have some matrix, 2 times 2. I can diagonalize it, right? So let's zeta be the exp of 2 pi I over A, then we can consider the map xy goes to zeta x, zeta to the, say, b times y, maybe actually c, and then take c2 modulo this equivalence relation. Similarly to what we did in the exercises, you can compute the invariant polynomials, invariant monomials, just rephrase everything that's said here in terms of the lattice. And then you get some particular, the invariant functions here, so k cxy invariants will be, well, let's call it h, maybe. H z mod a will be the k of c for some c. So as we discussed this, the only choice is some number coprime with A. So the number B and number C can be expressed in terms of each other. It's an exercise how do they actually can be expressed. Okay. Now what usually people do in toric geometries, for every cone, we can consider the dual cone. So given C inside some lattice M, we can define dual. C dual inside M check, that's home. And the dual cone, you exchange the vertices and linear relations. As you discussed, for cone we had two definitions, either it's a convex hull of finitely many vectors, or it's intersection of finitely many hyperplanes. So just when you, every vector is a linear functional on the dual space, and every linear functional is a vector in the dual space. So either you take convex hull of the corresponding L's, or you take this way. Or just can, you can define it abstractly, C dual is the same as L inside M hat, such that for any V inside C, L of V is non-negative. Yeah, so, and there's a duality, so dual of the dual is your original cone. So C dual dual equals to C. This property holds for actually all convex convex closed cones inside space, not necessarily polyhedral, but if you start from rational polyhedral, then its dual is again rational polyhedral, and you can go other way around. So, so usually we choose cone C inside N. As you recall, N is the dual lattice. N is home MZ, and M was the lattice of the characters. These are functions on the thing, home G to GM. And then to cone C, we can associate an affine variety. So it's A, let's call it X. C specter K of C dual. This construction has some advantage, this dualization, because now we can compare different varieties that are associated to different cones. So the cone, it has some facets. In particular, if you take cone like this, then we can consider this ray or this ray, and it's also a cone. So the facets of the cone are a cone. How to construct a facet? You just throw away some of the equations. If you had some equations, you just can take out some of them. Now, so what will be the property? So if say C prime is a facet of cone C, then variety X C prime has a natural embedding inside variety C. So let's consider again, one-dimensional case, the maybe very instructive. So we had, as you recall, just four distinct cones. So there was just a point, this line, and whole line. And so if we dualize, what will be the dual of just a zero? We consider all linear functions such they are non-negative inside zero. It means any linear function. So dual of this is the whole. What is the dual of the positive direction? We look all linear functions that are positive and positive numbers. It means that they're again positive. Also in some notations when you do dual, you replace non-negative with non-positive, but that's just up to choice. That's, so here it's the same, and here we go to zero. Now, what are the cone algebras here? So this was the k of x plus minus 1, y plus minus 1, so that's gn squared. X plus, it's one dimensional example, x, that's our original torus. So we see that in this construction, the smallest possible cone, just zero, corresponds to the smallest possible toric variety, just the torus. It's the very bare thing of it. Now if you look here, then we get k of x, this a1, and this corresponds to adding point x equals to zero. Right, so on my torus, I'm missing 2 points, I'm adding one of them. So this gives me k of x to the minus 1. This is again a1, but corresponds to adding another point, x equals to infinity, in a sense. And this guy, it does not correspond to anything, right? So it's just a point. So usually it's better to disregard this thing, right? So ask our cone to be not the full space. But for, it means for the dual cone, it means the dual is not this. Okay. And now we see that this guy is embedded to here, and this cone is embedded to these two cones. So similarly happens in higher dimensions. So if you start from so again, now dual of a point is a plane I already drew just directly. Now, what is the dual of array? Dual of array is a half space, right? I look for functions such that they're non-negative here. So it's a half space. So that's k of x plus minus 1, y plus minus 1. That's k of x and y plus minus 1. And if, for example, I consider some basic cone, like this, then its dual will be again the basic cone k of x, y. So now I can just, if I have some bigger cone, so just if I have some cone, then all varieties that correspond to it, to its subcones, they already contained inside my original variety. So I have some, they just given by so-called localization. I choose some polynomial and say that this polynomial is non-equals to zero. For example, how to go from here to here? I say that y is non-zero, then it's invertible. How to go from here to here? I say that both x and y are non-zero. From here to here is x is non-zero. Right, so this now picture gives me so-called covariant functor. So to cone, I associate a fine variety. To subcone, I associate a fine subvariety. And now I can define what is a fun. Definition. Fun is a collection of cones, say here on a plane, such that intersection of any two cones is again a cone, is a facet of both of them. Fun sigma is a collection of cones ci inside of cones means rational polyhedral cones as usual ci inside M R such that for any I, all facets of CI, they also belong to the fun. So if I have some cone, I should have all its facets. And for any IJ, CI intersection with CJ which means just an intersection on the plane, as I do the usual intersection, is also a facet for both Ci and Cj, which means that I cannot have overlapping cones on something positive. So if they attached one to another, this is good. But if they overlap, that's bad. Now, why is this definition? Because what does it mean? So for every cone, I associate some affine variety. For every facet, I have some open subsets that open there. And then I want just to glue all this affine variety along their open subsets, identify using this identification. So to a fun sigma, it's not an M, it's an N. As we discussed, it's more useful to have the cones and the dual thing, so then we have this embedding. If you do them in the original lattice, then we don't have, it does not work. Right, so for every, so that's why this N is called fun lattice. That's where the fun naturally lives. To a fun sigma, essentially this N and the lattice, it's a part of the data, right? So actually to associate toric variety, I need the lattice and a collection of cones inside this lattice, so it's inside that vector space. To a fun sigma, we associate toric variety X sigma as union of X Ci over Oi. Right? For every cone of a fun, I associate some affine variety, and then for any these two affines, they intersect along a sub-variety that's given by variety associated to intersection of their cones. Let's look maybe how it works again in dimension one and in dimension two, maybe a few examples. Here I draw some examples of the funs. For example, cone itself is a fun. It's just you take cone and all its faces. It's a fun. Here I have two cones of maximal dimension and some smaller cones. Here I have, say, four cones of maximal dimension. This variety is actually P1 times P1. This variety is a projective plane. It has three cones of maximal dimension that corresponds to three coordinate charts of here. This is just a fine plane. And this variety is the quotient that we constructed, A1 singularity, A2 mod Z mod 2, spectre of K of XY. ABC, B squared minus AC. This variety does not have, I think, any particular name, but it has two singular points, as we already noticed, and these two singular points are different singular points. One is 1 over 3, 1, 1, so-called, another is not. Okay, so let's look a little bit for dimension 1 and 2, how just this construction works, and then we finish. So in dimension equals to 1, how many funs are there? So if I fix a lattice, how many funs do I have? You already remember we have three non-trivial cones, right? And we can, so cones are this and this. So funs, we can either do this one. Let's call it one. Just trivial fun. Can do this fun. Prime. Just other way around and so there are four funs on a given lattice. What are the varieties that they correspond to? This corresponds to GM, our original torus. This is A1 spectre k of x. This is a1 vector k of y, where y is 1 over x. What is this guy? So here I have two cones of maximal dimension. This means I have two affine varieties. Both of them are affine line, and they intersect along a torus. Right? If I say x non-zero is the same as y non-zero, and y can be expressed in terms of x. So this is a1 with coordinate x union with a1 with coordinate y. Along transformation, x is a union over gm, so x is 1 over y. Yeah? So you can see that this gives me a projective line. That's a construction of a projective line. If I have projective line, it has projective coordinates, but if one of them is non-zero, it's an affine line, right? So all directions in a plane, if I say throw away this direction, then I can identify my line with coordinate here. If I throw away this direction, then I can identify my line with this point. And these two coordinates, so this is, say, one x, one, and this is one y. So y is equals to one over x, right? Because these three points, they lie on the same line. Okay, so that's one-dimensional case. Now let's look for two-dimensional case. And what's the nice property that if we have any mapping of the funds, it gives me a mapping of the varieties. What is the homomorphism of funds? My lattice is fixed, and it's just a map such that image of every cone lies inside the cone, something like this. Look for dimension equals to 2. So if I have just only a unique cone of maximal dimension, it's not really interesting, as we discussed. Just the fine variety, let's look for some. For example, if I have this thing, then what variety I get by associated to this fun? Actually, you can notice that for funds, you can define a product. You just take a product of the spaces, and the cones are product of all possible cones. So if I'm given two sigma 1 inside n1 and sigma 2 inside n2, then I can define sigma 1 times sigma 2 inside n1 times n2. Cij equals to ci product with cj. Then this guy is obviously, this fun is a product of this fun, this fun, right? And the product of funds, easily you can see it corresponds to product of varieties. So x sigma 1 times sigma 2 is x sigma 1 times x sigma 2. So this should be p1, and this is a1. So altogether, that gives me variety that looks like this. It's neither affine nor projective, right? It's quasi affine. Product of projective line with affine line. And on P1 I have two homogeneous coordinates, on A1 I have just the usual coordinate. And this all can be expressed in terms of all these things. Maybe look for this example. And then when we have fun made of three rays, so let's do it an exercise. So show that if this is sigma, then x of sigma is a projective plane. So what do I have here? I have three cones of maximal dimension, and every cone of maximal dimension, it's basic, right? So we see that areas of all parallelograms equals to 1. 1, 1, and here it's also 1. So my variety will be union of three affine planes along some identification. If you just do exactly from the definition, then you see that it's the identification for the projective plane. And to make some announcement of what will be the next time, maybe the exercise for everything what is drawn here, check what varieties they do correspond to for all those hands. So there's a little bit alternative approach to the same construction. So recall that example we started from. We had C2 modular group of two elements. XY goes to minus X minus Y. So in fact, we can realize the same thing as C2 times C star modulo C star. So we add extra coordinate Z and do X, Y, Z with respect to lambda goes to lambda X, lambda Y, lambda square times Z. Yeah. So why these two things are the same? Because here Z is non-zero, right? So Z is non-equals to zero. So using this map, I can find some lambda such that Z equals to one, right? So it looks like an affine plane, but then I realize that this choice of lambda is not unique. Lambda and minus lambda gives me the same. So if I fix it, so fix to Z equals to one, or sometimes physicists say gauge to Z equals to one. But then still lambda plus minus one, lambda equals to plus minus one still acts here, and I get this picture. So the similar statement, and also what is the projective plane? We had another definition of a projective plane as C3, throw away zero, modulo C star. So you see that both these examples, that's an affine toric variety, that's a projective toric variety, and we know the funds for them. So both are realized as something inside C3. So this is, you can say it's C3 without X equals to Y equals to zero. And this is C3 without X equals to Y equals to Z equals to zero. And in fact, to every fun, we can associate a picture like this, the quotient picture. So every toric variety is a quotient of a vector space subtracted some union of coordinate planes modulo a torus. And torus has dimension that related to number of rays. So that's the JIT approach that we will discuss next lecture. So far, you can just try to guess what should be this quotient. It's related to the idea that I told before. If you have a collection of vectors, say on a plane, you can think of it as an image of a collection of basic vectors in some higher dimensional space. So to this collection of vectors, you can associate some matrix. For example, here it will be matrix 2 times n, where n is number of one-dimensional rays. And the fun, the combinatorics of the fun corresponds to what you have to throw away from this. Okay, that's it.